we are here to talk about the future of the TV licence, if there is one, and the future of the BBC. Bearing in mind that the BBC have declined to participate in this event, I suggest that once we've all had our say about the licence fee, which I suspect maybe from different angles, hello, but I suspect there's going to be a little degree of overlap. I think we should probably look at other aspects of the future of the BBC as well as the licence fee, if that's all right with you. Let me introduce the panellists. We have, I don't actually know who they are, but I'm not familiar with all of their job titles. So Andrew Bridgen, who is a Conservative MP, he's been long campaigning to get the BBC licence fee abolished. We are hopefully going to have John Whittingdale with us a little bit later. Dave Atherton is Chairman of Freedom to Choose. Andrew Allison is Campaign Manager at the Freedom Association, and Alex Dean is Managing Director of Public Affairs and FTI Consulting. Is that right?
Yes.
Right. I thought you were somewhere else, but you've obviously moved. Right, I'm going to ask Andrew to kick us off. Everyone's going to speak for a maximum of 5 minutes, and then we'll open it up to a discussion.
Thank you, Ian. Well, I just asked the audience to imagine the situation. The BBC learned the Banana Republic, where the government had announced there was going to be a poll tax on all its citizens to allow them to view television, and this was going to be backed up by criminalisation of people who didn't pay the tax on time and imprisonment, and that potentially half the people who went to prison in that country were women with children. I think there'd be an outcry. Well, we don't have to imagine it. It's actually what's been going on in this country for quite a while. I actually put an amendment to the deregulation bill, which will set out for a review for decriminalisation of non-payment of television licence. And the shocking fact is that 1 in 8 of all magistrates' cases in this country, England and Wales, are in fact, prosecutions for non-payment of television licence. It's a criminal offence, and all those prosecuted, which I think ran to 193,000 of our fellow citizens last year, will get a criminal record, which they have to declare when they go for a job interview. On top of that, we're actually putting in prison between sort of 50 and 70 individuals a year for non-payment of fines associated with non-payment of TV licence. Effectively, for me, we're criminalising some people who undoubtedly are being criminalised for the fact that they're poor. It's a regressive tax. If people struggle to pay their utility bills, they normally get onto a lower tariff. If you're so poor you can't pay your council tax, you get a rebate. But there is no release from the BBC licence fee. And I completely understand that no organisation that's got criminalisation for protection of its income stream is going to give it up easily. And the BBC will say that if we didn't have that, evasion rates would go through the roof. Well, that's just not true, and the BBC knew it wasn't true when they were opposing the amendments to the legislation, because effectively Scotland decriminalised many years ago. Scotland only prosecuted 34 people last year. And their evasion, and I imagine they were people who were determined for various reasons not to pay. So they only criminalised 34 people. We criminalised 193,000. And the evasion rate in Scotland is only 0.5% different to the evasion rate in the UK, in England and Wales. And I put it to the audience that if you were in some sort of little bothy halfway up a mountain in Scotland, you might think you perhaps had a better chance of getting away without meeting an inspector to get your TV licence checked over. The heavy-handed way in which the BBC collect the licence fee is actually shown by the correspondence I had from magistrates who hate, and the magistrates themselves have been calling for decriminalisation and getting rid of the licence fee in its current form for over 20 years. There's no doubt that it is a tax on the poor, and it gives people no choice. So if you don't watch television, you don't get a choice of whether you BBC programmes, you don't get a choice whether you pay or not. And I quite, you know, the BBC does need a funding mechanism, but this one's been going along since the 1920s as a radio licence, 1946 as a TV licence. Television has completely changed. There was, you know, when I was a boy, there was only BBC One and BBC Two, and they had basically a monopoly. That is not the case nowadays. We have an educated audience. The BBC had an opportunity where they went to Freeview to have set-top boxes at the time. They had the technology, was all there. They declined that because they wanted to keep the licence fee, and you can't blame them, but it's an anachronism. It's out of date. The BBC say they're world standard, and I believe they are, but the licence fee brings in about £3.6 billion of revenue. They're only making about £300 or £400 million from selling programmes worldwide. I think there's great opportunities to expand that. And just to put that into context, the £4 billion budget of the BBC would make them a FTSE 100 company. They're a huge organisation, and they can park their tanks on anybody's lawn in media circles. Their websites are driving local newspapers out of business. Their radio broadcasts are influencing, obviously, the commercial markets. And it's our money they're doing it with. To put it in perspective, the United Nations budget worldwide is £5.2 billion. The BBC's got £4 billion on its own. It's a huge behemoth. It's time for change. And let's get rid of have a real debate now about the future of the BBC. I honestly think as well that the fact that it's taken as a poll tax is putting a major divide between the people who pay for the BBC and the BBC themselves. BBC have got to be funded independent of government. They are an independent broadcaster. But the way they're funded with this tax, they're actually independent of the people who view their programmes, and that's a very dangerous place for any organisation to be. And that's the arrogance that's built up in the BBC. That's why you've had the massive payoffs of their executives. That's why you've got these situations like Savile. There is no transparency. They don't answer freedom of information regularly, and that's why they're not here to do it, because they don't feel they have to be.
Sorry, that wasn't a hint.
I think that's a hint.
Andrew, thank you very much. And one word, you mentioned the power of the BBC there. And maybe let me give you an instance as to where that power has been abused. Some time ago, I used to do a programme on a digital station called One Word, which was essentially a books and arts station. Quite successful. And then the BBC decided that it was so successful that they thought they would do it too. So they created BBC 7, I think it was called at the time. It's now Radio 4 Extra. Well, within months of them creating that radio station, One Word folded because they just could not compete with the power of the marketing of the BBC. Oh. And that's the sort of thing where I think that they need to think very carefully about sort of what they do in the future. Alex Dean.
Thanks. I agree with everything that's just been said, and we run the danger of giving the same speeches year after year about the BBC, I think. I mean, I would privatise the BBC if I had my way, and I don't think that the model, not just the licence fee, but its existence per se as a state broadcaster, paid for whether you like it or not by your money, is really justifiable. But that said, I mean, I remember speaking at the first Freedom Zone and setting out those views, and I set out those views at the Freedom Festival earlier this year, and I set out those views in the Free the Airwaves pamphlet produced by the Freedom Association, which I really encourage you to read. So rather than just saying the same things again, which I think we run the risk of doing on these panels, let me do something a little different and offer some helpful advice to the BBC. If they wish their charter, which is shortly coming up for renewal, to be renewed. You might call my contribution to the session advice not taken. But nevertheless, let me make a few points about the BBC that I think might help their case. One, consider the example of the British Council, which ahead of the last election and since the last election has cut hundreds of people from their staff payroll. You might ask why have they got hundreds of people in the first place, but nevertheless, cut hundreds of people from their staff payroll, reduced their expenditure, and engineered their own fundraising to the point that was just made about the BBC's broadcasting capabilities internationally, so that they now make over 60% of their budget themselves. That makes it a much more difficult organisation to attack for those of us on the right, even though it's in receipt of state funding and so forth. That's an example the BBC should really seek to pursue if they want to survive in their current form, I would suggest. When I say they should make cuts, let's consider the things they've got available to cut. The Brazil World Cup, the BBC sent 270 people to cover. That's more than twice as many as ITV sent, despite the fact that ITV had a 50-50 coverage agreement with the BBC. They were showing the same amount of coverage, but the BBC sent more than twice as many people. So I suggest there's a little fat that can be cut and trimmed there. The Sochi Olympics, they sent 100 people to cover the Sochi Winter Olympics, which is, of course, twice as many people as we had athletes competing at the Sochi Olympics. The Beijing Olympics, they sent more than 500 people to cover the Beijing Olympics. Your money, by the way. 500 people covered that. And then the Glastonbury Festival, I'm sure we were all gripped by the BBC's coverage of Glastonbury. 300 went to that party in the park. and cover themselves in mud at your expense to cover the wonderful cultural event that is the Glastonbury Festival. I suggest they could have done it with 250. So my point is there is room for some trimming at the Beeb, and I think that's more than a theoretical point. Secondly, they should put their house in order on the tax front. The BBC has been at the forefront of the self-righteous attacks on bankers, corporations, bonus culture, lawyers, but they themselves have many executives who pay themselves through dummy corporations.
And MPs. Yes.
And of course, MPs, quite right. And they've attacked MPs as well, that's right. But they have many executives who have companies which they pay themselves through for tax advantage. They cannot have it both ways. They cannot seek to moralise to the rest of the world whilst themselves benefiting from those kinds of tax structures. Mm-hmm. And if they put that to rights, and I think that's a basic HR point that you could fix quite easily, it would be much more difficult for us right-wingers to attack them. That's the second thing I think.
To be fair, they have done that to an extent.
They have done it to an extent, Ian. Mm-hmm. And I think the Mail reported recently, there's still a large number of people who have those contracts, and indeed, in the last contract round, a big bunch of people had new ones, was my understanding. Mm-hmm. Now, as long as there's one person who's getting that form of remuneration, to my view, the BBC has undermined its case, especially because it's taxpayers' money that's going to those individuals. A private corporation, if it decided that was the way it wanted to pay its executives, I might think it was weird, but fine. But it's our money. It's the state's money going to it. So whilst I applaud the fact they've made some efforts in that direction, more of that, please. And thirdly, and perhaps most importantly, they should contract out much more in programming. It would be very difficult for us on the right to attack the BBC's bias in political broadcasting if they had Martin Durkin Productions in permanent train producing interesting intelligence on climate change or the non-existence thereof, or if they had the Taxpayers Alliance Productions producing information about tax. And of course, for every suggestion that might produce biased broadcasting, we've got plenty of examples of bias to the left. The BBC has a mandate to, just like Channel 4, to contract out in its programming. It doesn't do it anything like enough. One, it should be supporting our private sector industry much more in contracting out, and two, it should genuinely reflect the political spectrum, by which I mean having some speakers from the right as well as from the left. And that includes its own hiring policies. They should hire and host, perhaps Ian, you'd be a good candidate, they should hire and host people to speak from the broad movement of the right on their shows, because I think most of us feel they have a broad cultural representation from the left. It again would be much more difficult to attack and undermine them if they actually had genuine right-wing voices on their screens. And I don't mean
what would you describe Andrew Neil as then?
Yeah, well, that's the trouble. That's the one example, right? And even Andrew Neil holds himself out as with a journalistic sort of, even when he's being mischievous and speaking from the right, a journalistic kind of host rather than a pundit. And the pundits that we get on the Beeb are people like Michael Portillo, who I don't think is even a member of the party anymore, and would certainly be on the left of the party if he was. So my point being, their go-to panels are people like Diane Abbott, hardcore left, and Michael Portillo, soft left. So, you know, you could have a better representation, I think, of the political spectrum than that. But I really mean it. I seek to assist Auntie in their case for getting their charter, because if things carry on as they are, the case for rejecting charter renewal, I think, will be very strong. So if they trimmed staff and cut fat, which I think they should do and could do with ease, I think it'll be harder. If they put their tax affairs in order, and I take the point they've done some of that, it would be better. And if they really sought to address this issue of political bias, which despite their own reports and confirming that there are elements of bias which even they admit to, they've done very little on, I think the BBC would be much better off, and we'd be more likely to see it retained in its current format.
Thank you. Dave Atherton from Freedom to Choose. What is Freedom to Choose?
Freedom to Choose is a smokers' rights organisation that was formed in 2007. And now the state isn't stopping at smoking, they're now moving into alcohol, salt and fat. And I've also covered betting and page three on the radio as well. And the point I'm making is I make about 50 to 60 TV and radio appearances a year. And I've always found the BBC to be extremely fair to me. They've never been biased against me as a smoker and defending a minority right at the moment. And that is in contrast to my experience in the private sector. In Talk Sport, for example, this presenter on in the morning ranted at me and shouted at me for 3 minutes where I can get a word in edgeways. On reflection, I should have reported it, maybe to Ofcom or wherever it is, or certainly to his boss. I've got his name.
John Gaunt.
No, I don't think it was. He was on with Annie Townsend. It was in the morning, it was about 3 years ago, so I might have changed it now. And also, as well, I was also on ITV's Daybreak with the less than cuddly Lorraine Kelly, Elliot Jones and Dr. Hilary Jones. Dr. Hilary Jones had come up with sort of barely GCSE standard test for smoking in cars. And I really did feel kind of set up for that because they didn't send me the results, which I could sort of query. I had to think on my feet when I was there. The second thing I want to move on to here is I think the BBC is reformable. If you go back 30 years ago, anybody who was in business, who was a capitalist, capitalism was always badly misrepresented on the BBC. But if you look at sort of current programmes like Dragon's Den and The Apprentice, entrepreneurs and business people who create wealth and employment are now being lauded and respected, and it's a decent thing to be doing. And possibly one of the, I don't know whether any of you guys here saw from 3 years ago, Evan Davis, the BBC's economics editor, he did a programme called Made in Britain. And before he went into what we produce and sell in this country, he gave his assessment of the current situation in the UK. And the first thing he said was, we've replaced our manufacturing industry now with debt. And the word he used is must be reduced, i.e. he was a great critic of how much the government was spending. He also went on to give one of the most stunning appraisals of free trade, and that free trade is the way to make us all wealthy. Now, I was sitting there, my jaw was literally on the floor. Now, he really did sound more like the Austrian School of Economics than he was a Keynesian. Now, I don't think, Martin Durkin, Mark Little of the Institute of Economic Affairs, or even Chris Snowden even, and Manson Peary of the Adam Smith Institute could have been a better economics discussion than that, or point than that. So, in conclusion, I do believe the BBC can be reformed. My last point is about the BBC World Service. I don't know whether you are aware, but from April of this year, it's now funded out of the licence fee. It's not being funded by the Foreign Commonwealth Office anymore. Do you know that, Alex?
Yes.
Yeah. Indeed. Yeah. And for £12 a month, I've always felt that the World Service is literally doing a service to the world. When you look at the Second World War, you look at the Cold War, the BBC World Service, I think it's 166 million people tuning into it every week, that you have a source of honest information, which the Nazis and the Soviets wouldn't have given you. And I'm pretty sure that the BBC World Service did do its part in helping to bring down the Berlin Wall and the defeat of communism. My final points on the BBC World Service is the first one that came out, the first World Service language that came out was Arabic in 1938. And we couldn't be more topical at the moment on the Middle East at the moment. The people in Saudi Arabia, Afghanistan, either on the web or on the radio, can hear honest, biased, if you like, pro-Western type news. In fact, when I clicked on the...
Honest and biased.
Oh, sorry, honest and biased. Sorry, honest.
Unbiased.
Okay. Thank you, Chris. Sorry about that. Honest and unbiased news. And I actually clicked on the Arabic page and via Google's Translate. And the most read article on the BBC's Arabic webpage was the mosque in South Africa, which is going to allow gay Muslims to attend, and ladies will be leading prayers and things like that. So you have all these people in Saudi Arabia, Afghanistan, and all the other fundamental areas of the Middle East who can actually see that there are liberal things going on in the world. And what the local imam decrees is not necessarily how the rest of the world is. So that's basically, to sum it all up, the BBC have been very fair to me. I think we can overstate the bias. And also, I think the BBC World Service that really must be worth £12 a month of anybody's money. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Andrew.
Thank you. As Ian said at the beginning, the BBC were invited, and I made repeated requests for them to come along. And I did write an article for Conservative Home, and at the end of it, I invited Tony Hall to come on and come on this panel, or Tony Hall send a representative to come on this panel. And we know for a fact that he did read that article, but still, he didn't get back. You'll see on your chairs, Axe the TV Tax postcards. Our campaign was originally called Free the Airwaves, as Alex mentioned earlier, and I've done a little bit of rebranding on that this year, and we've got the Axe the TV Tax campaign. So those of you who are on Twitter and Facebook, and if you want to like our page and follow us on those different social media outlets, please do. There's also a website there that you can go on to. Currently it's linking to various articles that I've written, but it will be a brand new website, so that's a little plug for that. And we're also pleased to announce today Martin Durkin's been mentioned twice, and Martin has kindly agreed to be the campaign's patron as well, and he's going to be helping us along, so that's good. The television licence fee is simply something of yesteryear. It's just not fit for the modern age. The best quote that I've seen this year was from the former BBC Crime Watch presenter Nick Ross. And he did a little piece for Daily Politics. And he said, the risk aversion is driving the BBC into a dead end. The licence fee, when it comes up for renewal in 2 years' time, will be 90 years old. And as every year goes by, it becomes more and more anachronistic. And he was saying that as someone who loves the BBC. And I don't hate the BBC at all. I've got many gripes about it, but I certainly don't hate it. I don't think everything that it does is wrong. But it is becoming more and more anachronistic. I mean, part of my job is to look at various Ofcom reports and just look at the new trends. And a recent report said that among 16 to 24-year-olds, only half of their time spent on watching activities is accounted for by live TV. And that figure is increasing in other age groups as well. I've got a 15-year-old son. He's lucky if he watches half an hour's worth of television a day. Children now, growing up, just don't even bother with it. Everything is online. Another interesting sort of statistic from that report is that 44% of households have access to a tablet at the beginning of 2014. That's risen a lot, up from a quarter the previous year. I think when you put in the fact that more and more people have got super fast broadband connections now, with things like Chromecast, you can get a tablet, a mobile phone, a computer, Beam, whatever is on your electronic device, straight onto a television screen, and you've got a smart TV there. And all of this technology is moving forward at such a rapid rate that we simply don't watch television or live television as much as we do before. I mentioned smart TVs. Digital TV research has said it's forecast to rise. Currently, there are 300 million smart TVs, apparently, around the world. That's set to rise up to about 760 million by 2018. And I think it's clear that as everybody starts to replace their television sets, they're going to get the latest technology, and that's how it's going to move forward. There's simply more content for people to watch. Whether it be on YouTube, Netflix, Love Film, it means that live TV isn't as important as it was, and certainly the BBC isn't as important as it was. And I think most people just find it completely bizarre, to say the least, that we are forced to pay a tax for watching live TV, whether or not we just happen to watch that broadcaster. And that is clear. There was a ComRes poll for White House Consultancy that said that 51% of people would quite happily scrap the licence fee, even if that means there are adverts on, even if it means that original programming is curtailed, even if the BBC loses its public service broadcasting duty, whatever that means. And I would have thought that the vast majority of people would be young, 16 to 24-year-olds, maybe under 30s, but it was interesting that 61% of those in the 45 to 54 age category wanted that option. I think the BBC is going to have just to wake up that if it wants to reform the way that it's funded, if it wants to do things on its own terms, it's going to have to start playing ball, as Nick Ross said. Otherwise, it's going to get everything thrust upon it. James Purnell, when I mentioned it, it was to do with Andrew's decriminalisation proposals. He said something like, well, we could lose £200 million a year if this happens, and that will affect children's television. So basically, if we decriminalise the licence fee, the kids are going to get it. They're going to lose out. And that was his basically say. He shut up after that, interestingly. But just total rubbish. In conclusion, I think this is essentially about freedom. If we read the Daily Mail, we don't have to pay for the Guardian. Taxpayers don't have to fund the Guardian. Under the last government, there were so many public sector jobs in the Guardian that you could be forgiven for thinking differently. Local example, if you want to go to Villa Park and watch football, you don't have to pay for Birmingham City. And I think it's just time, finally, that freedom was extended to broadcasting. And that's why it's time to axe the TV tax.
Of course, it's not just a TV tax. As a radio presenter, I should point out that you didn't mention radio once. And of course, radio listening is at an all-time high compared to TV viewing. Just so I throw that in there.
It is, and I watched the Select Committee report from John's committee, and it was very interesting, all the radio side. But you only gave me 5 minutes, Ian, and I can't cover everything.
You used to need a radio licence, and now you don't. So
pardon?
You used to have a radio licence, and now you
don't. But the TV licence covers, obviously, the funding for BBC Radio as well.
You have a radio without the television.
Well, indeed. John Whittingdale, you've heard four people here call for the licence fee to be abolished. As chairman of the select committee on these issues, what's your view?
This is the second fringe meeting I've done on the BBC. Last night I spoke at the Guardian's fringe meeting on the BBC, where I think I was regarded as a dangerous right-wing loony.
Was there a BBC person on that panel? Really?
Peter Salmon was on the panel.
Astonishing.
Today I'm probably going to be attacked from the other wing, because let me first of all say that I think most of what the BBC does is incredibly good. We have probably the finest broadcaster in the world. I've been around a lot of countries talking about the BBC and public service broadcasting, and they all say we want to be like the BBC. And programmes like Sherlock are selling around the world. Having said that, every 10 years we come around for a charter renewal, and we have to remember that last time the BBC charter came up for renewal, most households in this country had access to 4 television channels. Since then, we've had analogue switch-off, which has led to every household having access to at least 30 or 40 channels. We have had the advent of things like iPlayer, catch-up TV, live streaming, people like Netflix coming into the market. The whole landscape is utterly different. And that, at the very least, means that we should sit down and say, well, what does that mean for the BBC? What changes should they make? Previously, they were having to provide programming which wasn't supplied because there was only a limited number of channels. Now, we've got a plethora. And that has to mean the BBC has to change. And so charter renewal is a part of that. Now, there are 3 areas which I would like to focus on. The first and the easiest one is the way in which the BBC is governed, which plainly has failed. The creation of the BBC Trust, which was done by Tessa Jowell, has not been a success. There have been the most appalling failures of governance in the BBC, running through from editorial control, things like the Newsnight scandal over both the failure to broadcast the Jimmy Savile programme and then the programme they did broadcast about Alison McAlpine, although he wasn't named, but it was quite plain. There has been all of the scandals about payoffs, about pension arrangements, people leaving the BBC with a £1.5 million, £2 million pension pot. There has been generally a failure of governance, and personally I would like to move to a much clearer structure where the BBC has a clear external regulator in the same way that Channel 4 does, and then has a corporate governance structure within the BBC much more along traditional lines, with a non-executive chairman, non-executive directors and senior executives on a management board. That in a way is the easy bit, but it might mean that there will be tougher control over the management decisions. The next is the question of what the BBC does. Alex gave a few examples of waste. I mean, actually, not all of them I agree with. I mean, I think the BBC, if you look at something like Glastonbury or the Olympics, in terms of the amount of the hours coverage, it was far greater because they use things like Red Button and they have the radio coverage as well. But that isn't to say it justifies all the people they send. But that small beer, I mean, the greatest failure was something called the Digital Media Initiative, which was a project initiated by the BBC, which went on absorbing more and more money as it didn't work. So they threw more money at it, until eventually they turned around and said, this doesn't work, we're going to scrap it. That was after they had spent £100 million. It was £100 million written off on a project which most people knew was never going to work. And again, it was a governance failure, because they should have, a proper board would have said much earlier, look, you know, where is this going? Why are we throwing money on? And actually, I argue, I don't think the BBC should have been doing it in the first place. There are certain things the BBC doesn't need to do. We have incredibly successful IT firms who are developing new means of distribution via the online space and digital media. Why does the BBC need to do it? They could have bought it in much more cheaply, and then probably it would have worked.
For example, Red Bee Media.
Indeed, Red Bee Media, who are very good, who once were part of the BBC, but have now. And that leads me on to the next thing. Now, Alex talks about how he wants to see more programming from outside. Tony Hall made a very interesting proposal a couple of weeks ago, in which at the moment 50% of BBC programming is reserved for in-house. They have an indie quota, which they have to meet outside. Then there is this thing that they created a few years ago called the Window of Creative Competition, where the private sector and BBC compete. Tony Hall said that he's going to make it 100% competition. Therefore, there is no guaranteed in-house production in the BBC at all, which I think is a good step forward. However, on the other hand, he's also said that he will allow BBC production to make programmes for other broadcasters. Now, that's causing a little more concern, because this is a state-owned broadcaster, real big beast, that is going to start competing in the marketplace. And I understand the concerns being expressed by the indie sector about potentially the unfair competition that could represent. But actually, if you have a new creature, BBC production, which is competing against the indies for BBC programming, and is also competing against the indies to make programs for other broadcasters, there is no reason, in my view, why that has to remain publicly owned. Actually, you create a structure in which it's very easy to privatise it. And by privatising BBC production, it doesn't have any impact on the quality of BBC programming. If anything, it could lead to higher quality. You'd still have the BBC spending the amount of money on commissioning programming, taking the decisions, but you would have indie production covering all of the BBC's output, but apart from possibly news and current affairs, which I think needs to be treated separately. So that is an area where you could actually diminish the size of the BBC dramatically. There would be no impact on quality, or at least I can't see why there should be any impact on quality, and if possible, potentially it could actually go up. So those are the sorts of areas where I think we need to reconsider what the BBC does. I agree the BBC World Service is a fantastic institution, and actually I think we should be spending more on it, and the BBC say that they will do so, which I think is a good thing. And then you reach the third question, which is the BBC needs to be governed differently, the BBC needs to do less, but that which it does do, which as I say in main I think is good, the debate is around how you pay for it. And that is where there is the toughest argument, because whilst the BBC are willing to enter into the argument and the discussion on all the first areas, when Tony Hall came before us last, and he was very willing to discuss better governance models, he's very willing to discuss, you know, areas where BBC perhaps needs to do more, perhaps needs to do less, until you get to the licence fee. No debate, no discussion. They say the licence fee is the best form of financing the BBC, and we are not willing to contemplate alternatives. I agree with a lot of what's been said. Andrew has done a very effective campaign on the issue of the criminality of failing to pay the licence fee, but also it is wrong on so many different grounds. It is a highly regressive tax. It is a poll tax for which there is no means-tested assistance available. Even the poll tax have means-tested assistance. For the BBC licence fee, you don't. It doesn't matter how poor you are, you still have to pay it. It is extremely inefficient. It costs, in terms of the cost of collection of it. And actually now it's becoming more difficult, because in the old days you have those vans going up and down sort of saying you've got a television set there. But actually, because methods of receiving audiovisual content are changing so fast, you can no longer use that. And that's going to lead to higher levels of evasion as well. And the level of evasion is already quite high. So it's not great on a number of grounds, but the argument of the BBC has always been, well, actually there's nothing better. I think that in the short term, we possibly need to, well, clearly we need to change it so that it no longer is just about live-streamed content. I mean, it is absurd that you can watch something on catch-up 5 minutes later and you don't need to pay a TV licence, whereas if you watch it live, you do. I mean, that just is because at the time the licence fee was invented, that opportunity didn't exist. It's a new technology, so you need to update it. I think potentially you could link it to a household tax, as they've just done in Germany. But in the longer term, I would like to see it move towards a more voluntary system. And that may be a gradual one. So you could perhaps say, look, everybody needs to pay £75, maybe even £100. And that is the core public service programming. But if you want more beyond that, then you can choose whether or not you want to pay it. And Andrew made the point, and this was confirmed actually when Greg Dyke gave evidence to us, that you may remember Freeview was originally a project which ITV created, and was in desperate trouble and was bailed out by the BBC. And Greg Dyke was quite open that the condition of bailing out Freeview was that the set-top boxes should not have conditional access systems in them. And that was because the BBC knew that if every household in the country had a conditional access system in their set-top box, it made it very easy to move over to a subscription basis for paying for BBC. And that is going to be one of the requirements. If you want to have subscription, if you want to have voluntary, you've got to have an ability to prevent people watching material for which they haven't paid. So it will take time, but I think more and more the argument is swinging towards that, and it might be that it won't be in this licence fee settlement. But in the longer term, I'm completely convinced that licence fee is unsustainable. And you know, the arguments in favour of moving away from it become stronger every year.
Right, let's throw it open to the audience. If you'd like to say who you are, where you're from, if you represent an organisation, you serve them behind you. Wait for the mic.
My name's Rob Speed. I'm here representing Leeds North East constituency, and for my sins I also work for the BBC. I'm responsible for iPlayer development, a little bit of Red Button and various other bits and pieces with Bite Size and stuff, and I'm also working on the Young Coder of the Year awards. A couple of things, really. And one point you said was that newspapers are being put out of business by the BBC.
Local newspapers.
Right, okay. One of my cousins is a newspaper editor, and he's seen that sort of thing. And it seems to be more the internet and society has changed rather than directly the BBC. There's a couple of other things.
The BBC seem to, whatever sphere they want to go into, as Ian said, they copied a programme that he produced. They have the resources to be the very best they can be, and they will take over that sphere of it, whether that's internet news or whatever.
It's like there used to be a plethora of monthly football magazines. Then the BBC started Match of the Day magazine, and that is, well, there's four
point taken. Still, point taken. Yes, you do see
you
that.
You can park your tax on anyone's lawn you want to, with taxpayers' money.
Agreed. In fact, there's a bit of contention as to whether
he's a conservative. Are you not?
I am indeed, yes, yeah. Indeed.
I actually think you're right as well. I don't think the BBC is primarily responsible for the death of local newspapers.
No.
It is the development of online free content. People don't pay for newspapers because they can get it free online, and that is. isn't necessarily from a BBC website. It's from the local newspaper website.
And it's partly because local newspapers produce shit websites. So people go to the BBC.
I agree. Yeah, yeah. There is a point to
apart from Eastern Daily Press.
Yes, I am a Conservative, and I do intend to stand for a parliamentary election in due course. What was also mentioned was the number of people we sent to Brazil. I'd just like to point out that we sent a lot of people there from R&D because of, we're working on 4K television, and we had the very first trial of live IP streaming. So we needed to send a great deal of engineers for that as well.
I'm sure it makes a great deal of sense to trial your technology in Brazil rather than here in the UK where you have your building.
Agreed. But there are issues with transmission and handling. But new technology there is...
Alex, when you make those statistics, of course, and they sound sort of very convincing on the face of it, but when you dig a bit deeper, ITV don't have a radio station, for example. They had Five Live, Five Live Sports Extra. I don't know how many of those 500 were from then. The Sochi Olympics one. They cover huge numbers of sports. You can't relate it to the number of athletes that the British team says. I mean, it's a great sort of spin line, but that's all it is.
Well, when the House of Commons Public Accounts Committee in 2010 criticised excessive staffing at the BBC, they meant across every area and every aspect of what
they're doing. I'm not saying there isn't excessive
staffing. And I was simply choosing the cream of the example for rhetorical device, but this audience is intelligent enough to realise that that's what I was doing. So I was choosing the most eye-catching example, but it's a disease with which the body is riddled, and I was just pointing to the cancer on the eyelash.
Okay. Do you have a final point?
Yeah. Well, actually, three. If I can just try and condense very, very. Agreed. 300 people went to Glastonbury. If we look at what's happening here today, I mean, I think there were over 20 tents that needed to be covered for cameramen, sign men, and talent, as they're called, so people on screen talent. How many MPs are here in different places at the same time? So, yeah, how many people...
Quite sure I see the analogy there.
I agree.
We're not being covered by the BBC.
But you could argue the BBC have got sort of one of the smallest presences here, and they did it at Labour. It's not a Conservative thing. They've done it at all party conferences because they've been told to cut back.
Agreed, yeah.
And, I mean, my organisation has got a sort of massive stand here. The BBC is sort of coming, looking at it and thinking, well, why aren't we doing that sort of thing? Isn't that public service broadcasting? Shouldn't we have a bigger presence?
Yes, agreed. One thing that was also mentioned was that the budget. And for Salford has to spend 25% of its budget, so that's staff, premises and so on local companies. So the number of local tech companies and so on has grown massively, and you see it wandering around. There's various people from the small startups and so on. So there's over 350 small companies that have grown just from the BBC being in Salford.
That's a cost of 1.5 billion.
It was, I guess. Yeah.
I mean, if anyone wants to have a go at the BBC, that is the thing to have a go at them about that move. I mean, what an absolute disgrace. They've ruined Radio 5 Live as a radio station by not basing it in London. They've ruined BBC Breakfast because all the presenters just look at a screen because nobody's going to go up to Manchester. They're paying people to do paper reviews for 4 minutes on BBC Breakfast. They pay the contributor a fee of, I don't know, 150 quid or whatever. Yeah. And then they're paying often £300 for the return rail journey for 4 minutes on television. So don't tell me that that's value for money.
And also, when this stuff, before they moved to Salford, they said that we want guests there in the studio. That's one more idea. We don't want to deal any live links. And I know lots of people who end up on the train from London to Manchester, stay overnight in a hotel, are on, you say, BBC Breakfast, sort of a 2 minute interview.
I've done it. They've given me a hotel for the night.
I knew I'd be the left wing on. Move to Salford. I've been to Salford twice. I do think that the BBC were guilty of being far, far too London-centric. And actually, for as a criticism, that they shouldn't need to put people on trains from London to review papers. There must be some people living in the north of England capable of reviewing papers without coming up from London.
I think we're about to descend into another thing.
Apologies.
I'm going to stop.
The very final one was the 100 million that was spent on the DMI, which is the end-to-end chain, the digital chain. Not all of, yeah, I mean, obviously we pissed up them all on various things, but the vast majority of that is actually in use today.
So we're very glad to hear it. Right.
That's not on the public
just
accounts committee.
Just behind, so. And then the gentleman there.
Francis Lancaster. I was an archaeologist in Egypt and lived in Kuwait before
the
Islamic
Revolution. Not many of the pound.
So, of course, I know a lot about Egypt, and everyone here will know have their own expertise, but the BBC is a massive organisation. It can buy in expertise to produce, hopefully, high-quality news coverage. Its news coverage of the very essential so-called Arab Spring was incredibly poor. So, for example, a sixth form politics student could have gone to Tahrir Square, looked at all the young people fluent in English with the English signs, even if there were 150,000 of them, and said, well, this might be all the people who in Egypt speak English fluently, why not go into the Delta and interview a farming family who support the Muslim Brotherhood? And although we've had some better coverage of Syria recently, some quite insightful questions, programs in which they interview people on the ground, and they do that kind of program very well, the Beeb and all the other broadcast people who broadcast news, apart from Russia Today, they all look quite similar. They give a similar take. I don't know if they ask the similar people. And to my mind, the news coverage, which is held up as the gem, on the contrary, it simply isn't good enough.
It isn't a question of
bias. Although they are biased. Yes, they are biased. Not just biased. And when they try and go independent, John Snow, for example, whose journalism is absolutely outrageous, and I would have him prosecuted... Yeah.
But it doesn't work for the BBC.
Channel 4. But when you're trying to find some kind of alternative, I'm talking about the wider range of things. How you do it? How do you raise this standard of news coverage? If even when you go outside the Beeb, you actually get coverage that's worse, because the Beeb, and I'm agnostic about the license fee. What I want to see is a British gold standard organisation. Educating people in my country. And that, you know, has anybody got any ideas how we can improve this? What is, you know, a poor thing, which nevertheless is advertised as if it's brilliant.
Changing the ball. Right.
Andrew, what about this question of opinionated news coverage? Because, yeah. I mean, the gentleman is right about Jon Snow to the extent that he has his own opinions and isn't afraid to voice them on air, which in this country we're a little bit unused to. But then again, I mean, on my radio show, people, I have to obey Ofcom rules, but I'm paid to have opinions. So if I'm covering something, I will give an opinion on it. Now, depending on people's views, I think it's outrageous that he should offer an opinion on that. How dare he? But I think we ought to get a bit more grown up in this country and accept that journalists have opinions, and as long as they're not trying to hide that if they have agendas, why not allow more sort of, if you like, biased current affairs presenting? I don't mean necessarily in the main news programmes, but when you're having discussions, Andrew Neil, I think, sort of gets away with things that possibly other presenters don't do because he's Andrew Neil.
I agree with you there, Ian, but what Jon Snow's journalism is doing is not challenging the dominant idea.
Did you see his interview with Ed Miliband? That was an interview that the most right-wing person in this room would love to have done because, I mean, he challenged Miliband, he made Miliband look an absolute idiot.
Jon Snow can get away with it.
And that was great. I mean, anybody in this room, go and look at it. Even you, sir, as his most adamant critic, would think it was a wonderful interview. Alex, what do you think about this? I mean, is it possible to ever have totally unbiased news coverage?
No, it's not. But the case of the BBC is different qualitatively and in principle to every other broadcaster because we pay for it. I do not mind left-wing broadcasting. In fact, in the same way that I like to have members of Parliament truly and robustly expressing their views rather than, you know, bland people going through the motions, boring snoring, I would far rather have really outspoken polemic journalism across the whole spectrum. But I shouldn't have to pay for the views of those with whom I disagree. And my view is that the BBC is innately centre-left, whether it's culturally left because of Andrew Marr's position or politically left or whatever. My view is that's generally where it is. They should be able to have that as a corporation, just not on my dime. So if it's going to be a state broadcaster, even if it's impossible to be truly neutral, it should really try hard to, and I don't think that it does. Why not free them? Why not let them do what I think would be really in their nature and be an out-and-out left-wing broadcaster? And the way they get to that is to be free of their state position. But if I may just say this, because we were varying from the principle of this session in the and another thing principle of which we were all guilty. It may be that abandoning the licence fee is in the BBC's best interests.
Yes.
Right? If you want to retain the... If you disagree with me and you think it's good to have a state broadcaster, then look at examples like Australia, where they have a state-funded broadcaster and it doesn't come anything like so critically attacked by those that disagree with its position because they don't see vans out in the street, prosecutions for people who don't pay, and so forth. I think the BBC's got it completely wrong when they stick their heels in and say we must have... the licence fee conducted in the way that it does as this tax.
It is in fact their nemesis.
Much more, exactly right, much more in their interest to get rid of it.
John, do you think that sometimes Conservatives see bias at the BBC where maybe there isn't any meant?
Yeah, I do. You'd be amazed the number of Conservatives working in the BBC, not just our friend in the front row, yeah?
Well, trying to cover up, and so it ends up being quiet.
But actually...
Well, that's very telling, isn't it? You have to cover up.
I mean, Alex mentioned Andrew Marr. I don't think any of us are in any doubt where his political sympathies lie, but equally, you know, he was replaced by Nick Robinson, who is a Tory. And Nick Robinson is a very good professional journalist. He doesn't let it influence his reporting, but nonetheless, he is a Tory. The producer, Robbie, we know, he's a Tory. There are lots of Tories in the BBC. I don't think they're partisan. I think that they are guilty of a view of the world. And it comes out particularly in the coverage of religious issues, it comes out in their coverage of Europe, it comes out in their coverage of the Middle East. Yeah. They're not pro-Labour, but they are pro a particular view of the world, and they find it very difficult to deal with people who hold a different view of the world.
Yeah.
And that's reflected in who they invite on as their commentators. You know, you will always hear us on the Today programme, people coming on and saying the government is failing because it's not spending enough money on A or B or C. You almost never get the Taxpayers' Alliance or a representative from Right coming along on and saying, actually, you know, we're in a mess, we are paying too much tax, we shouldn't be spending so much money. It's just the way from which they go. And that, I do think, is a serious failing, and we will continue to raise it. But the other area... Gentleman who talked about the Arab Spring. I chair the British Ukraine group in Parliament. I was spent for the first 3 days last week in Kiev. The coverage of what has happened in Ukraine on the BBC has not been great, nor has it been on many other broadcasters. But actually, the reason I think the quality of BBC international news coverage has declined is because the BBC has cut the amount of money they're spending on it. And the BBC did take a hit in the last licence fee settlement. They got no increase in the licence fee, but at the same time they were required to take on the World Service, S4C, BBC Monitoring, broadband rollout, and the amount of money available for programming went down by about 30%. Now, there are areas where actually I think they could have spent a lot less and probably it would have been better, but they instead applied it across the board. And news coverage, in my view, is what the BBC... It's not the only thing they're about, but it should be almost the first priority for the BBC. And I think that the quality of BBC news has suffered because actually they make cuts which they shouldn't
make. It's interesting. If you look at Al Jazeera English, which I'm sure many of you do regularly, I mean, joking aside, that is a channel that the BBC ought to be looking at to think, well, okay, that's how to do foreign.
And I've been to Al Jazeera at Doha, which is staffed almost exclusively by former members of the BBC.
But what one difference that you, to pick up on the point about sort of who the BBC employs, yes, they do employ a lot of Conservatives, but they also, but it's usually Conservatives who sort of, as you say, kind of hidden their past. They employ lots of ex-Labour activists as political correspondents. They would never employ someone like me with a Tory background as a presenter or a political journalist. I absolutely know that, and I have no ambition ever to work for the BBC. I've made that clear right now, because I know I would be constrained in what I could do and I wouldn't be very good at it.
So can I just pick up on what John said about the World Service? Because it's been a thread that's gone through the discussion, and Dave sort of held it up as a one of the reasons that the licence fee should be justified in the modern era that it pays to the World Service. In my view, and I agree with everything that's been said about the quality of it, in my view, the World Service was where it should be when the FCO paid for it.
Yes.
But it is part of promoting this country abroad, promoting our values and our insights on the world, and it's a great way of promoting the UK, promoting Britain. When it was placed under the licence fee, for understandable reasons, at least in part, it was a good way to make the BBC have to cut some of their budgets elsewhere. But when that was done, it had a reverse effect to what many on the right might have intended. It meant it could be held up, as has been happening in this session, as a defence for the licence fee per se, which is wrong, in my view. It should be separated out. It does something qualitatively different. And I defend the existence of the licence fee, even if we privatise, defend the existence of the World Service, even if we were to privatise the rest of the BBC. So it's actually confused the issue, perhaps deliberately, in fact, confused the issue about the licence fee by offering it a new best defence by pointing to the World Service, when actually it was where it should have been with the FCA.
Actually, I have to say that I'm a bit more comfortable that this has been paid out of the licence fee rather than the Commonwealth Office. Simple reason, theoretically, it should be less potentially to be affected by the two bias. If we're paying for it as licence fee payers, it's probably going to be reasonably free of interference from elsewhere. I appreciate over the years it hasn't been so far, but I'm quite happy it's actually...
Well, whether it's funded by the licence fee or by the private...
Let's move on. Gentleman in the red shirt.
Three main strands. First, pick up something Alex said about... Tom Joyce, you did want names. Something Alex said about more independent companies. Wouldn't it be great if Company X had a permanent contract from the BBC to produce stuff? Yeah, but then they're under the control of the BBC. It's just because a company is independent, if the BBC is buying everything they produce and have the ability by turning off the contract to make it collapse, that's not really independence in any meaningful sense. Move on to something Ian said about BBC 7 Radio 4 Extra and tying it back in with Alex said about saving money. At least 4 Extra, as it currently exists, is making use of one of the BBC's greatest assets, its marvellous back catalogue. I mean, where else can you listen to The Goon Show and The Navy Log? I think maybe people in the past said, oh, we don't like repeats, and maybe on main channels they don't, but the back catalogue of the BBC is actually a national treasure. There is an awful lot of tremendously good stuff. My final and my sort of more substantive point is the BBC is, in some ways, it's fallen into the trap the NHS has, that people think it is a good in and of itself, rather than ask, what is it that we are trying to achieve? The point of the NHS is not to have an NHS, it's to ensure that no one cannot afford to pay for the medical treatment. No one who needs medical treatment won't get it because they can't afford it. If you go back to that, the whole structure of it, you look at it a different way. With the BBC, what is the point of it at the moment? Particularly, as you say, now we have TED Talks, now we have Netflix, now we have everything. Do we need a Reithian statement of what the BBC actually should be doing?
Right, I'll take that as a comment. Let's go, gentlemen, there, and then we'll come round there.
Yeah, Chris Snowden Institute, Economic Affairs. I wonder if anyone on the panel has any idea how many people the BBC think are going to stop subscribing if there was a subscription model. And it seems to me the subscription model is so obviously the right thing to do. The I can only assume that they think a huge number of people would not pay for it. Of course, it's theoretically possible they'll end up with more money because there's a hell of a lot of people not paying the licence fee at the moment. And the subscription model will force people, if they are going to watch the BBC at all, to watch it. But it will at the same time obviously give people who genuinely say, I don't believe that many people don't watch BBC channels, but you know, if people genuinely don't watch BBC channels, they don't pay for it, fine. Does anybody know how many people the BBC suspects are not going to pay for it? Because it seems to me that if it's one or two, if nearly everybody's going to pay it, BBC's got nothing to worry about. If it's 30% of people not going to pay for it, morally indefensible to be forcing those people currently to be paying.
Well, the BBC uses two arguments. It says that everything's diverse, there's something for everyone from the BBC, and it pushes it like that. Now, if there's something for everybody from the BBC, then everybody will want to subscribe to it. So it's a false argument. I just go back to what Nick Ross said, it's becoming more and more anachronistic. And the BBC is just driving itself into a dead end under this current system. It should be obvious, moving to a subscription system in the future, it will take a while to do it. It will take a number of years, but it should be obvious that is the future. If people are willing to pay £5 a month, we'll be all about the BBC back catalogue. If people are willing to pay £5 a month for Netflix, for example, then I'm sure if it came to the BBC back catalogue that they would probably want to pay £5 a month for things like that as well, and the BBC could raise revenue that way.
Right, before I come to Alex, John has to leave us. We thank him for his contribution. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Sure. Is this finished?
Yeah. Yes.
Alex.
Just to say, the question you've asked, Chris, to my mind, demonstrates the peculiar flaw or paradox at the heart of the BBC's case, which is that it offers a superb, unrivaled service for which you must pay at pain of imprisonment. I mean, if they are truly confident about the quality of their output and have confidence in what they do and that it appeals to an audience, then a subscription service has nothing to fear for them.
Okay, right. Gentleman there has had his hand up for a long time.
Colin Smith from New Forest East. I wonder if we could go back for a moment to TV licensing and the methods used to collect the license fee. I do agree that the strategic object should be to eliminate the license fee itself. But in the meantime, TV licensing, how it goes about its business. Just to inject a personal anecdote here, when I moved to my present house about 13 years ago, I don't have a television. In that 13-year period, I've received something like 120 threatening letters, all of which explicitly make the assumption that I'm breaking the criminal law.
Yeah.
I don't talk to people on the doorstep from TV licensing. I say, well, I'm sorry, I just don't deal with people on the doorstep, which makes them very annoyed. I used to be very annoyed when they used to call on the doorstep, but actually nowadays they get very annoyed when I don't engage with them. But I think it's wrong. I've got this quite considerable archive, which I'm very well happy to make available to campaigners and to John Whittingdale's committee if they want to open a little investigation into that. No win, no fee lawyers and human rights lawyers don't get a great press nowadays, and I'm very sympathetic to that, but I could be very interested in them given my own experience, which I think, you know, I've been harassed, my privacy has been invaded, I think you could talk about demanding money with menaces, trading standards, breaches of privacy, you name it. I'd be very happy to clean up on that front, and if anybody wants to make use of my experience, I'd be very happy to make my correspondence available to them.
But it goes even wider than that. If you buy a new television nowadays, you have to fill in a form, which is then sent to TV licensing. They then send you a letter to say, we don't have a license registered to you. And say, no, that would be because the television license in my house is registered in my partner's name. And they say, well, yes, but you're not on it. I said, no. Well, I said, how do we know that you've got a license? I said, look at your bloody computers. And slam your phone down. But what you do in these circumstances is if you have a Twitter following, you shame them on Twitter, and it gets sorted out very quickly.
I've spoken to government ministers long ago who obviously have a TV license in their home in their constituency. They have a very small flat in London, and decided they don't have a television there. You can see it in the House of Commons. You don't need it there. And I spoke to ministers who've been writing for years to TV licensing, and they don't take any notice of them either, and still bombard them with letters. So you would have an opportunity. The review into the decriminalisation, the potential for licence fee, has been announced by Sajid Javid. They're calling for evidence. That's the sort of evidence that we need to see, 120 letters. And just for the record, I mean, I have constituents who've come to me who've been harassed by, you know, a chap who had just divorced. He'd lost all his belongings to his ex-wife, and he actually hadn't got a TV. But he felt so harassed, he went and bought a TV licence. Didn't actually own a television.
Andrew, I've just got one point. This is not necessarily the BBC's fault. It's Capita who they've outsourced it to, isn't it? The collection of the licence. Yeah. It's Capita, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's up to the BBC to sort it, though, isn't it? I mean, there are loads of instances. I moved house a couple of years ago. We were trying to sell another one. And sure enough, yeah, every month into the empty house comes a letter from Capita telling me I need a TV licence. Yeah.
And assuming that you are breaking the law.
Yes.
Assuming. Exactly. Under any other circumstance, weren't there an instrument of the state doing it, it would be classic harassment.
Yeah.
If you go onto their website, there is a please leave me alone, I do not have a television.
But lots of people have done that, they don't pay any attention to it. And there's been so many instances where they just do not pay any attention to it.
That document only lasts for 2 years.
Okay.
2 years.
Okay. I'm going to call it quits, though, because I think we need to finish by two. And as I've dropped my phone down here, I think it's nearly two. So thank you to our panel. Thank you to everyone who's attended. Thank you very much.
Thank you.